Hello everyone, in this video we are going to discuss plane stresses and transformation of plane stresses. So let's first discuss about the plane stresses. Let's say we have a three-dimensional object that is being placed in x, y, z axis, and that object is being subjected to the multiple forces. So as a result of the forces, this body will be experiencing some stresses. So if we take small element of that object, this element will also be experiencing some stresses due to the applied forces. Those stresses could be the normal stresses and shear stresses. Now how we can represent those stresses? So let's say that the normal stress applied in the direction of x is sigma x, in the y direction as sigma y, and in z direction as sigma z. So there will be some shear stresses acting on these planes as well. So this plane, the same that I have taken, this plane is normal to x-axis. So let's say that this is x-plane. The plane which is normal to y-axis is y-plane, and plane normal to z-axis, this plane is z-plane. So how then the shear stresses will be represented? So the shear stresses acting on this x-plane is represented as xy, where x is the plane on which the shear stress is acting and y is the direction because it's towards the y direction. Similarly, there could be the other shear stress in the direction of z. So this will be represented as tau xz in plane x but in the direction of z. Similarly for others, this is for the y plane in the direction of x, in the direction of z, in z plane in the direction of x and in the direction of y. So if the body is in equilibrium, this body, then all these stresses will be balanced by corresponding opposite stresses. It means this normal stress will be balanced by the normal stresses on in this direction. Similarly, this normal stress will also be balanced by this direction. This will be balanced on the other side, and similarly the shear stresses will be balanced. So this is actually a 3D stress element. So since we have to talk about the plane stresses, when we are talking about a plane, plane is actually a 2 dimensions, not a 3 dimensions. So therefore, considering the same object, so in order to simplify the complexity in engineering practices, the stresses on one axis is considered as minimum or neglected. So let's consider the stresses in the z direction as minimum or neglected. In that case, then we are going to have a object in xy direction only. The same forces are being acted upon it, but now this is just an xy plane. So we are not going to discuss about z plane, considering that the forces has minimum or negligible effect in the z direction in order to have the simplicity. So same element now can be represented in xy plane as the normal stress in the x direction. So in order to balance, there would be opposite normal stress. Similarly, normal stress in y direction that will be balanced by the normal stress in opposite y direction. There would be shear stress as well. So shear stress in this plane would be xy, and that will be balanced by the opposite shear stresses. So the magnitude of x and y, the shear stress x and y would be equal, and that is clockwise, but the magnitude of shear stress in y direction will also be equals in order to make it balanced. So these are the plane stresses. Then we have the stresses in one plane only, and we have considered that plane as xy plane by neglecting the forces or stresses in z direction. Now the next very important thing that we are going to discuss is about the transformation of plane stresses. So considering the same object that is being applied to the number of forces, and considering an element of that object, the same stresses that we have discussed before. Now what we mean by transformation, like for example, if we know the condition of stresses at this plane, which is, let's say, is a horizontal plane, and now we want to know the plane stresses on a plane which is inclined to some angle like this one. So this can be calculated if we know the plane stresses on one state. So by rotating to any other direction, we can calculate the plane stresses. Let's say that this element is being rotated to an angle of theta. So in that case, now this axis will become then x dash and this axis will become y dash. So similarly, the stresses in x direction and y direction will get little vary, like the one that is being shown here. So how then we can calculate these stresses if we know the previous state of stresses? So this theta, which is actually being measured counterclockwise and taken positive. So let's derive an equation for the normal stresses and shear stresses on a plane, which is AA dash, making an angle theta with the x plane. So considering this right angle triangle, where the current state is this one, we want to know the normal and shear stresses on this plane. So let's say that the normal stress is sigma x dash, shear stress is tau x dash y dash. So we want to know the equation of this and this in terms of the current state of the plane stresses. Considering that this object is in equilibrium, then we can apply the conditions of equilibrium. But before applying the conditions of equilibrium, let's convert these stresses into forces first. We know that stress is equal to force upon area. So then force will be stress multiplied by the area. So let's say that the area of the inclined face, this inclined face has an area of dA. Then the respective areas, area on x plane would be then dA cos theta, and the area on y plane would be dA sin theta. So we know the area, so simply multiplying those with the stresses, so then we will be having the forces. Now all are the forces. Since we have to apply the conditions of equilibrium, so let's say if we are applying a condition that summation of all forces acting in x direction or y direction is equal to zero. So first then we need to have the forces acting in x direction or in y direction. So this is not an x, not an y, so we need to resolve this force component into the x and y component. These would be then the x and y component. Similarly, the shear force acting on this plane is not on x and y, so it should also be resolved into its components on x and y, so that we can apply the conditions of equilibrium. So now applying the conditions of equilibrium, the first condition of equilibrium, where we are going to get summation of all forces acting in x direction as zero, and applying the second condition where the forces acting in y direction would be equal to zero. So in these two equations, where we can see that dA is common in each term, so dividing dA with every term, then we are left with these two equations. And now we wanted to have the equation of this variable and equation for this variable. So these are two equations. So we can have a relationship for sigma x dash in terms of the known plane stresses. These are the known plane stresses. And also we can have the relationship for shear stress acting on x dash y dash. That simply can be done. Let's say that these are the two equations, multiply first equation with cos theta and second with sine theta. Then we will be having something constant, like you can see this is negative and this is positive. So adding them together, we are going to have an equation free from this term. It means then we can have an equation for the sigma x dash then. So simplifying further, we are going to get the equation for sigma x dash. So now we have got the equation for sigma x dash in terms of the stresses which were given or which were known to us before. The next thing that we are going to do is the shear stress acting on that x y dash plane. So how we can do that? Taking those same equations, now again we are going to do some basic calculation, multiplying first equation with sine and second with cos theta. So after doing so, we are going to get a equation which we have both as same sine. So then we can subtract this equation from this equation. We are going to get the equation free from sigma x dash, this will get cancelled. So then simplifying further, we are going to have an equation in terms of the known plane stresses with the unknown shear stress. So this is what we got now. So taking the same object that we had before, so now if we want to calculate the stress at a theta, and let's say that we are being given with this data, so simply putting into these equation, we are going to get the normal and shear stress on this plane. But hold on, we just have derived the formula for this and this. How about this then? We don't have formula for calculating the normal stresses acting on this element which is tilted to an angle of theta. So that can be done by orienting this x stress to theta plus 90, because this normal stress in y direction is at this angle. So in other words, we have got the equation for this. Here we have theta, but instead of theta, if we place theta plus 90, we are going to get the normal stress in the phi direction then. So what we are waiting for then? So then just placing theta plus 90 instead of theta with basics of trigonometry, cos theta plus 90 would be equal to minus sine theta, sine theta plus 90 would be equal to cos theta. So doing some basic calculations, we are going to get a equation in terms of the known stresses. So now we are successful in getting the equations for calculating the stresses on the plane which is inclined to some angle. If we know the stresses on a plane at initial state, and let's say if we are now changing the inclination of that element, then on that inclination, what will be the stresses? So those can easily be calculated using these equations. We can further simplify then. Again, with these trigonometric equations, we have cos squared theta somewhere, we have sine squared theta somewhere, we have sine theta cos theta somewhere. So just replacing with their respective values and then simplifying them, we are going to get the equation of these stresses into these terms. These are the other form of those previous equations. However, you can also use the previous equations. The benefit of doing it is it's easy to remember these formula, but again, they are going to give you the stresses on a plane which is inclined at angle of theta with the x plane. The last thing that we are going to cover is the sign conventions. That's very important, that if we have compressive stresses, then what kind of sign we have to take. If it is tension, then what kind of sign. For the shear stresses, what will be the sign for clockwise, anticlockwise, and so on. So if you have normal stress and that is tension, then that will be positive, same with the x and y plane. And if it is compressive, then that will be negative. How about shear stresses? If it is clockwise, positive, but if it is anticlockwise, then negative. These are the things that you have to keep in mind when you are doing the calculations for the stresses. So this is all from this video, where we have learned about the plane stresses, and also we have derived the formula for calculating the stresses at a plane which is inclined counterclockwise to some angle theta. I believe now you have got the concept of understanding the transformation of the plane stresses, transferring the plane stresses from one plane to another plane. So this is all from this video. Thank you for watching this video.